Now, let's introduce the algorithm of policy iteration. We'll first explain what policy iteration is and then discuss its properties. Afterwards, we'll break down the algorithm to see how it can be implemented through programming. What is this algorithm? Initially, there's an initial policy denoted as π0, which could be any given policy, perhaps not a good one. We'll iterate to find an optimal policy. Each iteration consists of two steps. The first step is policy evaluation, abbreviated as PE. We've mentioned policy evaluation before, that is, when given a policy, we can solve its corresponding Bellman equation and obtain the state value. This process is called policy evaluation. Given pi k, I solve v pi k. This is to evaluate the policy. The second step is policy improvement. Based on v pi k, we solve such an optimization problem to obtain a new policy pi k plus 1, which is better than pi k. Hence, it is called policy improvement. Why is it better? We'll explain later. This process can be represented like this. Initially, I have an initial guess π0, which usually isn't a good policy. Then I do policy evaluation to get vπ0, followed by policy improvement to obtain π1, then vπ1, π2, vπ2, and so on. How exactly is this algorithm implemented? We put that aside for a moment. Let's think about some fundamental questions first. There are four questions in total. Question 1. In the policy evaluation step, how to get the state value? Question 2. In the policy improvement step, why is the new policy pi k plus 1 better than pi k? Question 3. Why such an iterative algorithm can finally reach an optimal policy? Question 4. What's the relationship between this policy evaluation algorithm and the previous value iteration algorithm? For the first question, in the policy evaluation step, how to get the state value? Actually, we've already introduced this in detail when discussing the Bellman equation. That is, assuming pi k is given, we can write out its Bellman equation and solve its state value. There are two methods. The first is the closed form solution. If you're not familiar, you can revisit it in the previous lectures. Second, we don't often use the closed form solution because it involves solving a matrix inverse. We usually use an iterative solution. We start with a guess for v pi k and iterate until we gradually reach the true value of v pi k. It's important to note that policy evaluation is an iteration algorithm with another iterative algorithm embedded in the policy evaluation step. So, it's a large iterative algorithm that involves a smaller iterative algorithm. Second question, why is the new policy pi k plus 1 better than pi k? Why is it called policy improvement? Pi k plus 1 is obtained by solving this equation when v pi k is given. We can prove that v pi k plus 1 is always greater than or equal to v pi k, making pi k plus 1 better than pi k. I merely give this conclusion here. For a detailed proof, you can check my book. The third question is why such an iterative algorithm can finally reach an optimal policy. First, we know there's a step called policy improvement. So the policy is constantly improving. Initially, v pi 0 might not be good, but as we improve, v pi 1 gets better and then v pi 2 is even better. Gradually, v pi k will be better than the previous ones. The best value, v star, is the solution to the Bellman optimality equation and hence the optimal state value. Intuitively, it seems that v pi k will reach the optimal value, but mathematically, it's not that simple. Why? Although we know v pi k is improving, whether it can reach the optimal value still needs proof. In fact, v pi k will indeed converge to the optimal state value as k approaches infinity. And the policy will also converge to an optimal policy. For a detailed proof, you can refer to my book. The fourth and last question is about the relationship between the policy iteration algorithm and the value iteration algorithm. First, when answering question 3 in the previous slide, the proof of convergence for the policy iteration algorithm actually relies on the result that the value iteration algorithm converges. Thus, it's based on the value iteration algorithm. Additionally, policy iteration and value iteration are actually two extremes of a more general algorithm, called truncated policy iteration. This will be discussed later. Let's now discuss how to implement the policy iteration algorithm. To implement this algorithm, we need to consider its element-wise form. First, let's examine the first step, policy evaluation. This is its matrix vector form, which is an algorithm that iteratively solves a Bellman equation. Its element-wise form can be described as this. Initially, I have a value for v pi kj, where this superscript j represents the value of v pi k estimated at the jth iteration. These are known quantities, and pi k is given. Thus, through this, I can calculate the left-hand side, and then substitute the left-hand side back into the right-hand side, iterating until convergence. Once they converge, we know we have found v pi k completing this step. The next step is policy improvement. This is its matrix vector form. Having found v pi k in the previous step, the next step is to update to pi k plus 1. The method is to solve this maximization. In its element-wise form, it appears like this. V pi k is here, these are known, and then I need to solve for pi. How? Inside these parentheses is actually q pi k, which I can calculate. Given several q pi k, what policy should I choose? We already know that the optimal new policy is to choose this ak star, which is the action corresponding to the largest q pi k. This whole process can be summarized as this pseudocode. For each iteration, say the kth iteration, there are two steps, policy evaluation and policy improvement. In policy evaluation, our goal is to solve v pi k. I start with an initial guess, which can be any value, then substitute this guess into an iterative algorithm until v pi kj converges. Now I've obtained v pi k. Next, in policy improvement, we first traverse all states. For each state, I traverse all actions. Having just solved v pi k, we can use this to calculate q pi k. What follows is straightforward. My new policy pi k plus 1 is to choose the action corresponding to the largest q pi k. After calculating pi k plus 1, I return to this step to compute v pi k plus 1, continuing this iterative cycle. Let's explore this algorithm further with a simple example to see how it works in practice. Here we have a grid world example with two cells and a target area on the right. The optimal policy is evident. Move right when in the first cell and stay still when in the second cell. We aim to find this optimal policy using the policy iteration algorithm, starting from a random initial policy that suggests moving left in both cells. Let's see how it can find the optimal policy. This is the setup for the problem. Each cell has three actions. AL move left, A0 stay still, and AR move right. When k equals 0, the first step is policy evaluation, essentially solving v pi 0. How? We can solve the Bellman equation, which, due to the simplicity of this problem, can be done trivially. Alternatively, when it becomes more complex, we can use an iterative algorithm to solve it. I'll skip directly to having solved v pi 0. Next, I need to calculate q pi k, which in this case is q pi 0. There's a relationship between q pi k and v pi k, meaning given v pi k, I can calculate q pi k. Having already solved for v pi 0, I substitute its specific values into this table, which allows us to get the values of q pi 0. The next policy, pi 1, is straightforward to obtain. I look at which q pi 0 is the largest in this table. This is the largest, so I choose AR for S1. For S2, A0 is the largest, leading to the selection of A0. This results in a new policy. By plotting this policy, we see that this policy is already optimal. Why? In S1, it chooses to move right, and in S2, it remains stationary. Since this example is very simple, we can reach the policy using just one iteration. More complex scenarios would likely require more iterations. In my offline teaching, I would give every student some time to work through another example with pen and paper. Since we're online, we'll skip that part. So far, we've learned how the policy iteration algorithm can be used to find the optimal policy. Now, let's examine a more complex example to see some interesting findings. The basic setup of this example has already been provided. Our goal is to find the optimal policy for a 5x5 grid. The diagrams show the policy pi 0 I randomly chose at the beginning, then the calculation of v pi 0, the policy improvement to pi 1, the policy evaluation to get v pi 1, and so on, all the way to pi 10 and v pi 10. You can see that the policies in the intermediate stages are not optimal, with the policy for some states being quite chaotic. By Python, the policy is optimal. Starting from this point, in fact, starting from any point, we can reach the target area. Why doesn't it pass through the forbidden area to reach the target area when starting from this point? The reason is, as we see in the previous slide, entering the forbidden area causes a severe penalty. R forbidden equals negative 10. During this process, there's actually an interesting phenomenon. What is it? Let's consider Pi 0, which is a poor policy since it suggests staying still in every state. Pi 1 is also not good in many states, but we notice improvements in policies for these states close to the target area. From Pi 1 to Pi 2, the policy of this state becomes better. As you can see, the policy here is not good since it moves right while moving left, could reach the target area. Then, from Pi 2 to Pi 3, the policy of this state improved again because it was moving upwards here, and now moving left can reach the target area. As we continue, we'll find that these also improved gradually, and by Pi 5, policies for these states have also improved, and by Pi 9, policies for states that are closer to the target have improved, while those for states that are farther from the target have not yet improved. This illustrates an interesting phenomenon. The policies for states closer to the target tend to improve first, while policies for states farther from the target improve later. Intuitively, why does this happen? Mathematically, we can see the reason from the mathematical equations. Intuitively, in a given state, choosing the greedy action heavily depends on the policies of other states. If surrounding states have bad policies, choosing the highest action value might be meaningless. However, if other states have policies that can reach the target area, then choosing to move towards those states would yield a positive reward, making that greedy action indeed optimal. In summary, when the surrounding states cannot lead to the target area, a state's policy won't be able to reach the target either. But once neighboring states can lead to the target, the policy for that state will be able to lead to the target.